Welcome to the Amphibian Press podcast. I'm V.S. Holmes, and with me today is B.K. Boes, who's the author of the fantasy book Mother of Rebellion. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me. I'm excited.
So just for those of us who haven't read your book, give me a little bit of a backstory and tell me a little bit more about it.
Okay, so my book is the first in a series, so it's going to be probably 6 to 8 books. I'm about 67% of the way through this first draft of the second book, and I hope to be finishing that up soon. But it's basically along the lines of like Brandon Sanderson's Stormlight Archives or George R. R. Martin's Song of Ice and Fire, or Fire and Ice. Mm-hmm. So it's like a multiple point of view, really truly an epic fantasy. So it's I've got 5 point of view characters. And it kind of spans a lot of time. The characters live in different places all over the continent, and their stories kind of come together for like this overarching series plot. So they each kind of have like their own stories that kind of affect each other at first in small ways, and then throughout the series they start to come together, and like the actions that are taken in and earlier on in the series, you see how they kind of domino into these larger effects across the continent. And these characters who seem like they don't have anything to do with each other, their stories just all converge. So it's a pretty wide scale type epic fantasy. And it deals a lot with, my stories are very character centric. Mm-hmm. So I get that comment a lot from readers, is that they really enjoyed getting to know my characters, that my characters really pulled them into their story. And that's kind of where my strength would lie, I would say, is in character. In the first book, the main storyline has to do with, there's actually a couple of main storylines, but one of the main storylines has to do with basically a woman who is enslaved in this very militaristic society where the Attikians, they believe that their blood is like pure, and they're kind of, they want to kind of conquer the continent, and they're very aggressive, and they bring in other people as slaves in their society. They don't enslave their own people. Mm-hmm. They enslave foreigners. But what they do is all of the slave sons, they're sent to these canyons where they either survive or die in their training to become warriors for the society. And the boys are kind of brainwashed into thinking that this is how they purify their blood, or this is how they gain value in some way, is by serving the nation in this military capacity. But the woman who kind of begins the story and who the book is named after, Imra, it starts with, she has to send one of her boys, they send them away at 8 years old.
Oh gosh.
And so she has to send her young son away to a place where she knows he's either going to die or he's going to become part of the society that has enslaved her. And she's pregnant at the time. And whenever she has another boy, she has to make the decision to either shut herself down completely and emotionally detach herself, or do something about it. And she decides to do something about it. So that is kind of the beginning of the story for her and for her son. You also see her son, he goes off to the canyons. You kind of see his journey. And in the first book, you know, he's just a kid. He's 8 years old, and he's trying to assimilate into this and survive in these canyons. So those are 2 of the point of view characters. And that's kind of the inspiration for the name of the book. And Rebellion kind of runs through all of the storylines. There's other character, the other three point of view characters, there's a little bit of rebellion involved in their storylines as well.
I love that. So obviously you have this huge cast of characters, and I'm the same way. Like I struggle to write a book that'll have like one point of view.
I know.
I mean, and luckily fantasy lends itself to that, right?
Yes, exactly. And I do admit, you know, I have a problem. The second book adds another point of view character. but I think that's it, I think.
I had to finally like sit myself down. It's like, okay, if they only have one scene, that's it from their point of view, like
right.
just figure out a way to do it differently.
No, these people all have many, many scenes. I'm working on a kind of slowly, like whenever I need a break from what I'm doing now, I found this set of pre-made covers that I just loved. And so I'm working on world building and plotting for another series. And I told myself, this is going to be a one point of view epic fantasy where I do not add a bunch of characters. Mm-hmm. So I am going to try to do a series that is not quite so sweeping, that's right. maybe a little bit more focused on a smaller scale storyline. But that is not the series that my main series right now is definitely more along the lines of, like I said, a Brandon Sanderson multi-point of view type mm-hmm. story.
So do you have a favorite character? I mean, I know like we're not supposed to pick, but this is always like the question right. I love asking because everyone's like, I don't know.
This is so funny to me because my favorite character really depends on who I'm writing. Like whoever I'm writing at the moment is my favorite character. mm-hmm. So like whenever I look back over it, there are things that I love about each character. In the first book, I guess like, I don't know, like it's so hard for me to choose a favorite. One of the other point of view characters is, I do have a favorite society, mm-hmm. and one of my point of view characters, she lives within that society. So her name is Kayla, and she's also really young. She's basically in training to become a Roshleth, and Roshleths are history keepers for this tribal society that like lives in the desert, and their main source of income is like herding and like these sand beasts, and also trading between the countries on the coast and to the north. But they have a verbal storytelling history keeping type thing, and it comes through the leaders of their tribes. They have a patriarch and a Roshleth, and these are always couples that are kind of put together at birth or promised to each other at birth to lead a certain tribe. And the Roshleth's duty is to kind of keep, they call it legends and the stories of the stars. And so a lot of their stories are connected to constellations.
Oh, neat.
And it's all, they do write down some of their things, but basically the Roshleth's duty is to provide wisdom for the tribe's decision making, and through like conflict resolution within the tribe, and any kind of decisions that the leaders would have to make through the history and the legends that she has memorized throughout her whole life. So one of my characters, Kayla, is in training for that. And I really like that society is my favorite society within mm-hmm. within the world that I created. So I guess I have a favorite society. Does that count?
Yeah. I always like the different juxtapositions we can create as fantasy authors of these different societies, because, and I think that's one of the things that the multiple point of view can kind of give us, because we can see all of these cultures from within in a way that you can't necessarily yes. show them.
Yes, exactly.
So Of these characters, I've recently, so I'm finishing up my fantasy series now, and I always wonder, like, is there one for you that has been the most difficult to write, difficult to get in their head?
And, a character?
Yeah, and if so, why?
So I have three point of view characters that are men. Mm-hmm. And as a woman, sometimes I find it a little harder to get into like a man's head.
Right.
But so I have one character that is, he's a young man, but he is not an alpha male type figure. And I feel like I can identify with him a little bit better. And then, so I think the hardest character for me to like identify with and write is Moloch. And it's because he's like, he really is more of an alpha male type figure. He's a leader. He's very prideful. And he's involved in the leadership of one of the nations, and he's involved in the military of that nation. And so I had to like actually read George R. R. Martin and the Game of Thrones books in mm-hmm. order to like, and I watched a lot of like military movies and TV shows and read books like with point of views from that, like a character that was similar to like his what his mindset might be in order right. to kind of understand where like his thought process is and what he might how he might react to certain things and why. So there are parts of his character and parts of his story that I definitely have to like research whenever I come to a situation where I'm like, well, how would someone like him react? Because right. so it is difficult for me to kind of, there are some things about his character that I definitely can imagine and get into a little easier. Like he has a rivalry with his twin brother. His father has basically pitted him and his twin brother against each other in order to see who's going to be his successor. Mm-hmm. Because they're twins. And so he's like Moloch has to compete against his twin brother, and there's a rivalry there. Like that part of his character, I feel like I can like get into it without having to like really focus on like getting into his head. Like I can, right. it's a little easier for me to do that part. But the military stuff is always like, okay, I really did have to. I had to read more of that type of thing. And I had to like, I watched some TV shows and different things to try to get into that mindset. Mm-hmm. So that was probably the hardest.
That's really important too. Cause like, I mean, obviously a lot of us do research from like the more technical side of things, I think,
you know, right.
weapons, technology, horseback riding, mm-hmm. whatever it happens to be.
Yeah. Yeah.
But there's a lot of stuff that you sort of don't think about. Mm-hmm. That, you know, maybe a reader wouldn't necessarily notice unless if either they're like that character.
Right.
Or
right.
something else. I took a military history class in university. And it was it was like the best thing for my writing, because luckily our professor was like super engaged and into it. And especially the stuff about like trench warfare completely mm-hmm. changed the way I wrote about war, because mm-hmm. it's the side of stuff that we don't necessarily think about.
Yeah, no, I watched like a whole day. I spent watching video, like YouTube videos on ancient strategies for like military, like marching orders mm-hmm. and like battle plans and like how people, like ancient peoples, would organize their attacks and things like that. Mm-hmm. And I just took like sat all day just watching these YouTube videos and like. Taking down notes, because I feel like there are a lot of YouTube videos that kind of like break it down for you in right. a very in layman's terms, so that mm-hmm. like you can understand and there's visuals to help me like figure it out. So well, I definitely have to get a little bit more help in those areas.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, it's like you're able to get into like the little tiny pieces when it's something that's broken down for like, you know, like a 10-minute video or something like that.
Right, right.
That's good. The big scope of fantasy and writing series like this, Mm-hmm. Are you a pantser or a plotter? And like how much planning went into the overarching series plot for you before you actually started putting words on page?
Right. Well, writing a big epic fantasy like this is definitely, I think, one of the hardest genres to tackle. Mm-hmm. And somebody told me that after I'd already spent like a year building, like world building and plotting and doing all these different things with this story. I'm like, thanks, but thanks, I'm already like a year into it. Thank you. So they were like, I don't think you should start with this kind of story. And I'm like, I've already started. So anyway, I spent a long time world building, writing shorts. This started with a short story idea that was kind of set in the world, and it just grew from there. I found out that I'm an underwriter, so the first draft of Mother of Rebellion was really not a first draft of Mother of Rebellion. It was kind of like a first draft that was really like a really detailed outline of what I wanted the series to look like.
Oh, wow. That's interesting. I'm the opposite. That's why I'm like, how do you do that?
So I kind of like discovery wrote this, this very underwritten, 150,000 word story. And then, as I was looking at it and sharing it with people and trying to figure out what to do with it, I realized, oh, okay. So really the first like 20,000 words of this, could be turned into an entire book on its own. Mm-hmm. So like, and I was really discovering a lot about myself as a writer, through this process. So it's kind of a trick question whenever somebody asks me, well, how long did it take you to write Mother of Rebellion? Because I started out kind of pantsing it, but then as I realized that I couldn't pants it without like, and fully, like it was so underwritten. It was really, like I said, more like a detailed outline. Mm-hmm. And so once I did that, I started plotting, and I tried plotting really detailed outlines. Like you might have heard Brandon Sanderson's like plot for like the Stormlight Archives is like super detailed. Like, right. Like he knows exactly what's going to happen at every step of the way. And I found that didn't work for me. Mm-hmm. So basically I've kind of fallen into this middle ground between pantsing and plotting. So I like to have big, like the big plot points and mm-hmm. like a basic, like a sentence about what's supposed to happen in this chapter, a couple sentences maybe in my plot and my outline. But I really need to leave myself open for some discovery, because otherwise I get really bored and demotivated. Right. So I'm kind of like in the middle between those two extremes, I guess. So that's kind of where I am in terms of plotting versus pantsing.
I am recently, like my friend got into this story blueprinting thing, and I've mm-hmm. always been like a super outliner, you know, like first version of the first book aside, because that's always like, am I even going to do this thing? Yeah. But that aside, I've always been like a super outliner, but then I change my outlines like multiple times throughout mm-hmm. the different drafts. Mm-hmm. And so then I'm like, well, am I really an outliner, like existential crisis?
And you know, something interesting is that I actually outline more, I do a more detailed outline after I've written the book.
Yes. Yeah. When you're going back for revisions.
Yeah. Check it.
That's exactly
to make sure that I've hit everything correctly. Mm-hmm. You know, and if I'm missing something, like the plotting devices, like the hero's journey will help me see what I might have missed. Like,
right, yeah.
I do go back through and kind of check it against some plotting devices to make sure I've hit, you know, the right notes.
Mm-hmm. I think too, like, I mean, when it's a series and you're already are well introduced to these characters, it's a little different. But I think as you write, there's no amount of outlining that can necessarily help you get to know your character the way that actually writing them does. So sometimes like I'll get in a scene and I'm like, they would not do that. That is not how that person works.
Yeah. Yeah. That sometimes can cause big problems. You're right. Like, oh, no. Now I have to redo the entire rest of my outline. Right. I'm like, and sometimes I'm like writing and then I'm like, oh my goodness. And I'm just like, oh, this is so good. And I'm like, but wait a minute, you're not supposed to be doing this. You're not supposed to be doing this, but you have to. Oh no. And then I'm done writing it. And I'm like, well, okay. So
it's better.
Now I have to think about all this other stuff that I wrote that is now either no longer applicable or needs like a complete overhaul to fit with this new storyline. So that does happen to me.
Yeah, I've got the file folder of like basically deleted scenes that it's like, well, maybe if I find a character who does act like this, I can strip some of the details and rework it. Like, because there's, you know, there's some good lines in there, whatever.
Yeah, yep.
So tell me a little bit, you know, switching gears here, about Call Me M.
Oh, so that was a short story. It is a short story, but it basically, I was in this group of writers in a Facebook group, and it's a pretty small group, and we decided to all release short stories that were linked together in some way. And originally, it was very like we cross promoted it, and it was part of the Alteruvium Expanse, is what it's called. Mm-hmm. And it was really fun. And I completed it. And now, kind of like everybody has kind of that's the origin of that story. It's a science fantasy,
okay.
YA. It's the link between all the stories was it's set in a system with two suns, I think it was.
Binary system.
And it's also, there was like a common name, there was like a name for the, like a bad guy, like a villain, that everybody had to use a version of that name. So it kind of turned out like across the series, it kind of seems like in my story, that person is like a boogeyman type of thing that isn't exactly like part of the story. It's more part of the world building. Mm-hmm. And so it kind of turned out that like all these stories, and a lot of people did that, where they have like this, it's kind of like this common legend boogeyman type villain that's either completely legend or possibly like very real, depending on what you like world you're on or something. And now that that is actually eventually it's going to be a short story that leads into either a YA science fantasy serial or like a trilogy or something like that. I'm thinking it's probably going to be a YA serial of long short stories or possibly novellas. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure. So, but it's basically like in the world I created, it's all of the cities are domed cities because the atmosphere isn't breathable. And so there's a lot of like the science fiction part is there's a lot of like tech and things like that. But then the setting seems like very science fiction, but the fantasy part is that the people born on the planet, a certain bloodline, like kind of like this elite part of the society that they're kind of like all come from common ancestry. Mm-hmm. They develop kind of like superpower type magic. There's kind of like a superhero world, but in like a science fiction setting, not on Earth. So I haven't actually fully developed that plan yet.
Right.
So it's kind of been on the back burner, but it's something I'm really interested in and I really want to figure out. I just haven't done it yet.
Yeah. I haven't dabbled in like science fantasy or the space opera genres really. Because yeah. I do like both sci-fi and fantasy, but I have like hard sci-fi series on one side and then epic fantasy and never the twain shall meet. So
yeah. No, I actually like, I don't think I could do hard science fiction for myself because I really like to make up my own rules.
Right. Yeah.
And I don't necessarily, I enjoy watching science fiction and I enjoy reading some subgenres of science fiction for sure. Mm-hmm. But like whenever I'm writing it, I'm always too concerned about like being so concerned about getting the technicalities right.
Right.
Really kind of takes some of the fun out of it for me. And so I won't ever get anywhere near hard science fiction. So, but I have a couple of science fantasy YA ideas that I hope to one day be able to flesh out. So
now, Mother of Rebellion, is that YA or is that adult?
No, it is adult.
Okay.
But it does have like some young characters in it. But I mean, most epic fantasies of this kind do have younger characters. I mean, I think several of George R. R. Martin's characters are like young, like mm-hmm. like a couple of mine are. So are like children, like a child's age. So, but it is for adults. It definitely has, I mean, it's like pretty PG-13.
Right.
Like I don't have anything like that I think that a 16-year-old, 15-year-old could read it, and I don't think any parents would have an issue with it, as far as like that goes. But it is not marketed towards YA, like mm-hmm. a YA audience.
So tell me a little bit about what's next for your series, because I know the first book is out, and as you said, you have many more planned, which is so exciting.
Yes.
It's always nice when you fall in love with the world and you're like, oh yay, there's gonna be more.
Yeah. So, like I said before, I underwrote a few drafts of this book. And so I actually have portions of many books in this series already written that I just need, like, basically I had a tendency in those earlier drafts to just like skip years worth of story and I'd just be like, well, I don't know, but this is what happens, 2 years from now. So, right.
Meanwhile, back at the castle.
Yeah. Anyway, so the second book is actually during one of those. Most of the second book is brand new material, but I actually have quite a bit of the third book already written, due to that underwriting. So,
it's nice to have that light at the end of the tunnel when you have like such a huge project. Cause I mean, like it can be really exciting, but I know like I'll get bogged down when it's like, oh my God, there's so much left. It'll never be done.
Yes.
Oh my God.
I have a basic outline, for the story that goes to the end of the story. And my plan is to just keep writing until the story is finished. And my guess is, like I said, that it's going to be about 6 to 8 books. My day job, as it were, is a freelance editor.
Okay.
But I was doing that from home last year. The year before that, I homeschooled my two kids. I was homeschooling my two kids while I was trying to build a freelance editing business and write my book.
That's tough.
And I was like, that's too much, man. Because my husband is also a minister. And so like a lot of our time is taken up just caring for other people.
Right. So, yeah. Community.
Yeah. So I don't really have the option of like, sometimes like my schedule can't be my own, mm-hmm. And so, with the two kids, and I was just like, okay, so we started sending the kids to school last year, and I really focused on, I was still working from home. And then starting just a few months ago, I actually moved into a new office area in my area that was like super cheap to rent. And
oh, that's so exciting.
I've been like 100% more productive since moving into this office space. However, I moved into the office space and like 2 weeks later, like one of the copy machines burst into flames.
Oh God.
and so like the whole floor was like closed off. And then I had to move my office again to like another floor in the building. Mm-hmm. So got it all set up, and that was like a deal. And then I had to get everything cleaned.
Oh, God.
And then set it up again.
I'm glad you didn't lose anything in the fire though.
No, I did not. It was just like, there was just, and my office was on the other side of it. Mm-hmm. But anyway, it was dramatic, and it happened all over the holidays, and my life is just hectic over the holidays. And so, I feel like I'm just now getting into the swing of things here, but, yeah, so my plans are, I'm putting in a lot more writing time this year, mm-hmm. Than I ever have been able to before. And so my plans are to just write as much as possible and finish as quickly as possible. I've got about 67% of the second draft done.
That's exciting.
And about 20% of that has been since like mid-January, mm-hmm. Over the last month and a half. So I've really made, and then the first 50% of that was over like a whole year. So I've really been able to up my production. There was also a period of time where I was kind of learning a lot about marketing and all mm-hmm. the other stuff that goes into indie publishing.
It's such a business.
It is.
There's so many aspects.
Right. And so I had to kind of like take a minute to learn about that stuff, but my plan is to finish. I am definitely not going to George R. R. Martin my readers or Patrick Rothfuss them.
Yeah.
Like, it's not going to be 7 years until the next book. It's going to be, I'm hoping to get it out by the end of this year.
Yeah.
But it is a big story. So yeah. My plan is, I have a short story that is available only to my newsletter subscribers.
Ooh,
that
awesome.
Is one of the side characters. It's his story before you meet him in Mother of Rebellion.
Mm-hmm.
And he's a fun character, but the story, I always think to myself, think to myself, oh, this short story is so fun, but it's actually really dark.
Right.
So, like whenever I think about it, whenever I tell you people like the storyline, I'm like, oh wow, that sounds really dark, but
it's really fun if you like murder.
Like, oh, it's very fun. So that story is, I have other story ideas like that, and I have other spinoff ideas that I would like to write within the world that kind of tie into like side characters and their stories. So the world itself, I have a lot of plans for the world itself,
mm-hmm.
That I'm really excited about. And I'm trying not to set my goals unrealistically, because I've done that in the past, and I just get like kind of crushed whenever I can't meet my unrealistic goals.
I'm in the middle of that right now, so like it's like I don't know what I was thinking.
Yeah, and I would think, well, I should be able to do this. I should be able to do it, and I'm comparing myself to someone who writes full time, is not married, and has no kids.
Right,
and I'm like, you know, I should be able to do what they do. And the truth is I can't, you know, I can't write realistically, 100,000 words every month.
Mm-hmm.
I have done that before, and I can do that sometimes, but my life is just not flexible enough or, predictable enough to say for sure I can do that, you know? So,
right. Do you have any idea when the second book is going to come out, or is that sort of a long term?
Yeah. So like I said, I would like to have it done by the end of the year, mm-hmm. Like out and published.
Out and published. Awesome.
Yes. But I am not going to set any hard deadlines on that because I have not had anyone like, I think right now I'm thinking, hey, this is pretty awesome. This, what I'm doing right now, I love it. But like, as soon as I send it to my content editor, you know,
right.
There might be problems that I'm not seeing. So
what do you mean there's a massive plot hole? What do you mean I have to rewrite the second half of the book?
So I don't know. If everything goes perfectly, you know, it could be done earlier, but mm-hmm. like I also, my husband is actually, he's one of my biggest readers. He loves the genre. And so he actually is my target reader mm-hmm. and he does not sugarcoat things for me. So that's I good. Can kind of rely on him to give me good feedback. And sometimes whenever we're brainstorming together about something, cause I've run across a problem. There's been instances where I'm like, this is what I'm going to do. And he's like, I hate that idea, but I did it anyway. And he's like, oh, okay. I love it now. I see what you were saying.
Right.
So context. I can trust him to tell me whenever he absolutely hates something. And I don't necessarily listen to him all the time, but mm-hmm. I know that he's not going to sugarcoat it for me. So he's kind of like one of my first readers. I probably send it to him whenever I send it to my content editor and kind of see a lot of times they actually have some of the same remarks. So
that's good. Cause then you know that they're on,
that's confirmation.
On board. Yeah. Yeah,
exactly. So even as a freelance editor, I have an editor, so
good.
But even editors don't edit their own books, so or a lot of them don't.
Yeah.
I don't. So
no, I do line edits, which is sort of the same thing as like line editing my own stuff in some ways. But I always send it to mm-hmm. other people because it's like you're way too familiar with
yes.
the names and like the number of times I've misspelled my own characters' names mm-hmm. because my brain just autocorrects. Like no,
yeah. Yeah, I've had some really embarrassing, like, even whenever it comes down to the last stage of, like, copy editing, mm-hmm. I've had some, like, really embarrassing mistakes. Like, I cannot believe that slipped past. Yeah. I've had mistakes slip past me going over it multiple times, my editor going over it twice, like, 20 beta readers, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? And some of these beta readers are, like, retired English teachers. They're, like, they're really observant readers, and like whenever I send my manuscripts to my editor and then I have a proofreader, they always tell me how clean it is, and then but then there's like they still find things, you know what
right.
I mean, even though I'm like I produce a pretty clean manuscript, you know, over 100 and my first book is 175,000 words, over 175,000 words, I still have mistakes, mm-hmm. you know, that my proofreader has to catch. And I'm sure there are still some in there.
Like, right. I mean, there will always be, right? That's the magic yeah. of it somehow. I read somewhere that clean, like technically clean was considered one mistake in every 10,000 words.
Yes.
And after I read that, I'm like, all right, that makes me yes. feel a little bit better about that. Like one tenacious
yes.
one like, that's going to
that's an acceptable mm-hmm. rate of error. Yeah. For a published book, mm-hmm. but being independent, like over the years, you can find those mistakes and you can get rid of them. Eventually, yeah. eventually you've got to catch them all, right?
I mean, in theory, yes.
10 years from now, after going over it a million times, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. So where can my listeners find you?
I have a Facebook author page. My website is just bkboes.com. Really easy to remember. It's Boes, B-O-E-S, not like the...
not like the speakers.
Yeah, not like the speakers. This is like a German spelling, B-O-E-S. So bkboes.com. I'm on Facebook. I have a reader group called just BK Boes Reader Group. And I have an author page on Facebook. I'm on Instagram. I'm on Twitter. And then if you're looking for editing services, I have another website that's separate from my regular one. That's BoesEditingServices.com. Again,
okay.
Pretty
awesome.
Straightforward. So, but that's how people find me. And I'm always looking for reviewers. So
awesome. And if someone wants to snag that short story that you mentioned, can they find that on your website?
There should be a newsletter sign up on my website. You only get it through my newsletter. I have a sign up form on my website. I have one on my Facebook author page. There's like a little sign up button up at the top right hand corner.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
Those are all the ways I can think of to find me.
Yay. Well, this has been the Amphibian Press podcast. I'm VS Holmes. And with me today was BK Boes. Thank you so much for listening.